So I thought that if you had a few questions that I might be able to answer, then I am more than happy to take them on my community response fund. Yes. She said, of the 40 million, how much is going to the critical services? So what we've done is when we looked at how we were going to develop it, we looked at those services that under the P2P model had already been defined as critical. And then that was the services we were looking at as needing that help right now. How are we going to, A, keep them alive? Because we're certainly, there's not a day that goes by that I don't hear from an organisation that's struggling because their non-government money has dried up or has been reduced significantly. And then we looked at how we can help with that increase in demand. So the 40 million is not being broken up into chunks that go out differently, it just will be broken up over a 12-month period. So you have to be careful we don't spend it all in the first hit. So it will be spread out over the year. But then I wanted to extend it further than that because there's many organisations that don't get government funding. And that funding's drying up a little bit as well, so we wanted to make sure that they could be in there as well. So there's no actual split on whether it's crisis or demand. We're leaving that quite open, and those regional panels will decide that type of thing. Hello. Yes.
Minister,
I
just wanted to ask,
I'm not sure if you would have heard the question, but she said how wonderful I was. Paraphrasing there, no. The question was around whether or not we had held on to the bulk of the funding for the Pathways to Partnership, and the answer I can give you to that is yes. So what happens with the P2P funding was, and let's make sure I get these numbers, I'm not going to get these numbers absolutely correct for you, but what happened was is that a big chunk was spent last year. That chunk actually was taken out of this year's spending, because obviously the money that was spent last year was being rolled over. Yeah, so it wasn't one lot and then next year it's not paid out again. So that money is going ahead as it was. So if you got extra funding last year, that money is again being paid out this year. On top of that, after taking our CPI adjustments and other things, there was about $20 million left. So the conversation that we've been having with the sector representatives over the last couple of months is, what do we do with that $20 million? Do we continue paying it out in the Pathways to Partnership model of trying to get organisations up to 100% funding? Or do we recognise that in these extraordinary times that money needs to be spent a bit differently? And then what I did was I took to my Minister of Finance and to our Cabinet and said, actually, we are in very much extraordinary circumstances and we need more than 20 million, quite frankly. Can we bring some forward? So what we have done is not brought it forward from the second year because we think we're going to need every penny we can next year as well. We've actually brought it forward from the third year. So that's how we've got the 40 million to actually address this crisis funding, but Pathways to Partnership funding that was out last year is continuing as it is, and certainly the money that's funded via MSD, there's no plans to be cutting that. Most of you will be getting your contracts as they have been. No, it's got nothing to do with the wash-up funding. This is strictly the Pathways to Partnership funding that was trying to move organisations to the 100% funding model.
So is there wash-up funding aside?
There's no major changes to funding by MSD, thanks to know.
Is the government going to have a serious look at the gaming trust, the pokey money, and look at diverting, this will be a courageous act, diverting money from racing industry into social services. Mm. I know Richard Worth is poking around in there. Is there anything imaginative coming up here?
Yeah. The question was around sort of pokey money and the gambling money and if we're looking at that. I can tell you that it is run through the Department of Internal Affairs, as you would know, and that certainly Richard Worth is asking some questions of that at the moment, but we're at the beginning stages of that conversation. Yes.
You've spoken about the Community Response Fund as being to assist when non-governmental fund money drops off, and that the P2P will sustain contracts that are with the MSD or as planned. Do you have any response to situations where contracts which are not renewed, and what that and the effect that that might have on community agencies?
Yeah. So the question was about contracts that are not renewed. They're not necessarily part of the Pathways to Partnership. They're part of MSD and their funding, and so the Pathways to Partnership was on top of those normal contracts that you've got as such. So moving them all about 100%. Every year, it doesn't matter who's in government, you're making decisions based on the year ahead and how you will fund and how you will contract and what contracts are up for renewal and whether or not they still fit in with government priorities. That process is continuing. So, Richard is via his Family and Community Services is still running that program. But this is quite separate, so just to give you that interpretation. So last year, nearly $60 million was spent via the Pathways to Partnership Fund, and increasing funding for those that had contracts with MSD. So that amount will just carry over, so there'll be no additional funding going on top of that, but now there will be this additional fund that will be for those organisations that are having an increase in demand or a drop-off from their non-government funding. So it could be either. It doesn't necessarily, if you've been lucky enough to keep the money you're getting from trusts and from other sources, which I haven't met anyone yet that has, then you will still be eligible for the fund, but via an increase in service and demand. So that's what we're looking at. Yes?
Melissa, there's been some discussion in the Māori provider sector about integrated bulk funding models across sectors. So how do you see the scope fitting within that?
So the question was around integrated bulk funding models, and can I say that I'm hugely enthusiastic about it. I'm really heartened by the conversations, quite frankly, that are going on out there at the moment. I tell you what, people underestimate our sector all the time. They've got no idea how innovative we are, how in touch we are with actually what's happening out there at the moment, and how we need to come together to do it. So part of that, hence I wanted to make sure that innovation was part of the fund. So it wasn't just for those that are already in the circle, if you like, and already getting funded. We wanted to make sure that, sometimes out of tougher times come the best ideas, don't they? This is when we all start thinking about how we do things a little bit differently or what the needs really are there, and we wanted to be supporting that. And I don't know all of the details, in all fairness, but certainly my crude analysis will be that it seems to fit in with that.
Okay.
Yeah. So time for a couple more, so yes.
Just as a rider to the discussions within the Māori integration to that, is there going to be a fund to encourage groups to get together based on a geographic? Mm. And so I come from Te Awa or Hallertau, mm-hmm. and so several of us work together, but we all operate in our own.
Yeah.
So we're thinking about getting together to have a serious look at basically, are we duplicating all of those types of things? Can we draw together? Let's be innovative about integrating our services, and let's dovetail off each other in order to make sure that we aren't duplicating administration costs.
Absolutely. So the question just was sort of taking that a little bit step further and asking whether or not we're supporting that sort of geographic coming together of organisations and looking at duplication. One of the criteria of the fund is going to be that you have looked around your area and your geographic area, and that there isn't a double up or there is not a gap, somewhere else that could actually be fulfilling that need. So we're not funding one organisation a lot more, and yet, just down the road is an organisation that's actually being underutilised. So that's just one of our ways of encouraging organisations, and you're going to have to sign on the dotted line to say that you've actually gone out there, that you're coming together. So we will be encouraging that. We'll be encouraging it via the funding. So you will see a push from that, and I imagine that longer term funding, as I say, we are yet to sit down and have real discussions about how that's administered, so the money's there, and I just don't want to underestimate that to you. That is, that's really something that we're stepping up in these times when everyone else is absolutely pulling in their strings, and I can tell you that elsewhere we are, but when we looked at those demand for services, we wanted to keep them there, but there will be encouragement of looking at the sort of services within areas across the board, and how can we pull some of them together to actually stop that sort of duplication. Yes?
You actually answered that part of the question. Certainly budget services people are very hard coming into immediately. That's a problem.
Yeah.
And you're pretty well looking at doing that.
Definitely. I mean, we see there being substantial changes in the sector over the next 2 years, let alone us actually pushing it and doing it. We think that, as I say, I just think we're underestimated all the time as to actually, you know, the services propensity to actually get together and do it well. When we look at that, so there is going to become a bit of a merging coming together, there is going to be a little look at how we sort of structure it a bit differently, and part of that will be looking at longer term funding as well. Look, I'm really committed to funding some of the services differently, and that's no secret to some people in this room, because I like to talk about it as much as I can. When we, before this election, talked about, you know, a high trust model with community services, shock horror, we actually meant it. You know, so we're, there's a real push and a real pull from us to A, pull together more when it comes to sort of health, education, housing, social services, and get that together as to how we can fund it differently. And then look at that model where actually we're putting less restrictions, because we know at the end of the day, the job that you guys are doing on the grass is more than we could possibly ever do. We get far more for our buck than we can even measure. And we know, I mean, you hear those fancy formulas, eh? But the reality is, I just don't think we can even start to measure the effects and the positive effects of the work that you guys do. Yes, Cheryl.
Cheryl from Martin from Volunteering Auckland. We're talking today about resourcing the sector, and we're talking a lot about dollars. However, there's another part of resourcing the sector that is actually on the rise, and that is volunteering. Just with Volunteering Auckland, we've had a 100% increase from last year, people coming forward looking for voluntary opportunities. And I really want to encourage you to really look at your volunteer involvement that's going on within your organisations, and how that is another way of being innovative around making sure that our services are also being delivered. Because remember, we're never ever going to get all the dollars we need. So we really need to also look at that after having the resources, and that is the volunteers. And your volunteer coordinators and managers are the ones that will be doing the work, and they will be needing your support as well.
Did you all hear that? Because I think it's a really strong message from Cheryl, and doesn't that just hearten you for New Zealanders as well, that they're actually stepping up and putting their hands up and saying, what can we do and what role do we play in our community? So I just think it's quite a minute. Yes?
Why
do you
want to volunteer?
It's
very hard to find volunteers in these days, but my question is, you know, your definition of
well, my
focus.
So your question was around paid work for the NGO sector. The difference you're going to find with me is I'm not going to tell you how to run your organisations, where you put your resources, whom you pay, who you don't, and how you run it. It's not my job. You know your organisations far better than I do. So the push for frontline has just been with work and income, the ones I have control over. So if you're picking up those messages from me, then the frontline stuff is very much about work and income and child, youth and family. So as far as how you fund your services to meet the needs of your community, I mean, obviously we look at your books and we check that there's outcomes and that we're handing over the money responsibly, but how you fund and whom you pay is in my opinion, your call.
Well done.
Hey, thank you. Thank you for all coming out today. And, you know, I am just absolutely thrilled to be coming forward with good news. As I say, it's been pretty chilling from my perspective to be sitting there and knowing that really good organisations are struggling as much as they can. And I can just tell you that we completely acknowledge the need that is out there and that you are fulfilling it. And we knew that at the end of the day, government had a role to step up and try and fill some of that gap. So it is with pleasure that we actually stand here today and do that. So please hang around. I'm going to whip away for 10 minutes, but I would love to be able to answer any other questions that you might have that you didn't want to answer on the floor. So thank you for coming.